Amen. We are truly grateful and thankful for the fact that the Lord thought we were worth saving. Oh, what a blessing it is to know that God thought we were worth the sacrifice of his son, Jesus Christ. Oh, and I want to call your attention to a passage of scripture found in the book of Acts. We're in Acts once more and again, the first chapter, beginning with verse 15, and we'll be going down through verse 22. Acts, the first chapter, verse 15 through, not 22, through 20. Acts, first chapter, verses 15 through 20, and I'll be reading from the New International Version. The text reads and says these words. In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, a group numbering about 120, and said, "Brothers and sisters, the scripture had to be fulfilled in which the Holy Spirit spoke long ago through David concerning Judas, who served as a guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was one of our number and shared in our ministry." Verse 18 says, "With the payment he received for his wickedness, Judas bought a field. There he fell headlong. His body burst open and all his intestines spilled out. Everyone in Jerusalem heard about this, so they called that field in their language Akeldama, that is, field of blood. For Peter said, 'It is written in the book of Psalms, may his place be deserted. Let there be no one to dwell in it. And may another take his place of leadership.'" As we continue in our journey in the book of Acts, I want to talk to you all from the subject this morning. The work must go on. The work must go on. Let us pray. Oh, gracious and all-wise God, we come before you today to say thank you. Thank you for the opportunity and privilege to gather together with fellow believers in order to hear your word. Lord, we pray in this season, during this time, that all distractions can be removed. And that, God, we might be in position to hear your word so that in due season, the seeds that are planted will bear fruit. God, have your way now. We pray that we might be encouraged, strengthened, and guided by this time that we have to hear from you. It's in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. The work must go on. As many of you all know, the Moore family recently transitioned from the parsonage. As we moved into our home, we were greeted by an unexpected visitor. No, this was not the Karen that we talked about in Bible study, but rather this was a small, furry friend who boldly greeted us each morning on the back porch. Just to give a backstory, the previous owner was a cat lover. He owned a cat and somehow he began taking care of another cat in the area. When this family sold the house to us, they took the cat, one of the cats, with them. However, this other neighborhood cat remained in the area. Now, this furry friend shows up every morning looking to be fed. Yes, this furry feline has been able to witness that there are new people in place, but still has expectations that remain the same. This cat witnessed the moving trucks, taking things out and moving things in. This cat has witnessed a lighter hue leave and a darker hue arrive. And yet by his actions, he is still expecting for the work of taking care of him to go on. Let me say that one more time, that no matter who was in place, this cat is still expecting for the work of taking care of him to go on. So much so that he will make his presence known just to indicate that the work that was done in the past must continue in the future. And as I was writing this sermon, this cat came to mind, because this cat's ultimate concern wasn't the person, but rather the provision. While this cat understood that there were new people in place, it still had an expectation for the work that was in the past to continue in the present. And truth be told, my sisters and brothers, there are people out there right now who are not concerned about who is the president or chairperson of a ministry. They're not concerned about this or that, but rather they are concerned about the work going forth. Sometimes, even in the church, we base our efforts on personalities and people as opposed to being committed to the work that will never go away. And because of this, we come to see that ministries rise and fall with a person rather than allowing the work to go on because of a commitment to a mission. And yes, my brothers and sisters, this happens in every aspect of life. It happens in our families when we lose that great person who kept the family together, and now the family is scattered because no one has stepped up to make sure that the work could go on. It happens in our organizations where we had a president or a person who made sure that certain things were done, and now that they are gone, it seems like things are in moments of chaos and disarray. It has happened in our lives and even on our jobs, or there was someone who went above and beyond the call of duty, and now that they have moved on to other things, we are seeming to try to pull it together to figure out how they handled all of those different responsibilities. And all I'm saying here today, my sisters and my brothers, is that whether we like it or not, whether we want to take on the mantle or not, we still come to realize that the work must go on. You see, we come to realize that there are times where people will exit positions and still the work that needs to be done continues to have a prevalent and present importance. And yes, there are times where we allow for a person to go ahead and die out and their work to die out with them as well. But as believers, we must be willing to take up the mantle and do the work that we've been called to do. And here in our text today, we come to find a passage of scripture that shows us that the followers of Christ, these who were serving, knew that the work must go on. Here in our text today, as we look at the first chapter of the book of Acts, after arriving back in Jerusalem and gathering with over 120 brothers and sisters, Peter stands up in the midst of this crowd and lets them know that the work must go on. Those who are gathered here in Jerusalem are at a period of regrouping, and while they are waiting for the gift of the Holy Spirit, they find themselves committed to prayer, dwelling with one another, and remaining inclusive, as we talked about on last week. And Peter is also taking the time to prepare them for the work ahead. While they were waiting for the Spirit, they knew that the Holy Spirit would equip them for the work that must go on. Jesus had been telling them that even after his departure, that they would have a responsibility to go and be witnesses to what has taken place. They had to tell somebody about the good news of the Lord, not only in his life, not only in his death, but also in his resurrection. There were men and women both charged to go and tell it on the mountain. They were both men and women charged to go ahead and share the good news of the gospel. There were both men and women who came together even after the resurrection and ascension of Jesus, who were committed to the work, and they were waiting on the Spirit. And as they are gathered in this place, this speech of Peter's helps the people to become prepared for the work that was in front of them. While there are some complexities in the text, and even as we deal with what we're going to talk about next week, even in some theological challenges that we see, we ultimately see a spirit that says that the work must go on. And while we as a church are still battling pandemics, I say multiple pandemics on multiple fronts, we still know ourselves that the work must go on. Even as we continue to see that Black lives struggle to matter in this world, the work must go on. Even as we notice that people are being evicted from their homes and struggling to find food to eat, the work must go on. I know that we're finding ourselves still facing political turmoil and all kinds of craziness, but the work must go on. There are still people in need. There are still those who need to hear the good news. There are still people who need to know about the power of our God. And just because we've been worshiping in a different location, it doesn't change the purpose of our gathering and our organization. And as a church, we are still called to let our light shine in this dark world. As the church, we are still called to feed the hungry and clothe the naked. As the church, we are still called to help people to come to know the power of God. And Peter governs himself in a way that he makes it clear that the work must go on. And this brings me to a question this morning, and that is, how does Peter make it clear that the work must go on? Well, I'm so glad that you asked, because the first thing that we see here in the text is that he helps to make sense out of the mess. He helps to make sense out of the mess. Come on, pause with me, journey with me to verse 15 as it tells us these words. It says, "In those days, Peter stood up among the believers, a group numbering about 120, and said, 'Brothers and sisters, the scripture had to be fulfilled in which the Holy Spirit spoke long ago through David concerning Judas, who served as a guide for those who arrested Jesus. He was one of our number and shared in our ministry. With the payment he received for his wickedness, Judas bought a field, and there he fell headlong. His body burst open and all his intestines spilled out. Everyone in Jerusalem heard about this, so they called that field in their language a Keldama, that is, a field of blood. For said Peter, it is written in the book of Psalms, 'May his place be deserted, let there be no one to dwell in it, and may another take his place of leadership.'" Here we find in the text, as Peter rises to address his brothers and sisters in the faith, he begins to talk about the actions and the reality of what has happened with Judas. Instead of bashing Judas and talking bad about him for his behaviors, what Peter does is that he helps those who are gathered to understand that even Judas had a divine purpose. Let me pause right there for just a moment. He helps those who are gathered to understand that even Judas had a divine purpose. Here in the text, he highlights how scripture talks about him, and he helps to make sense of the mess that came about in his betrayal. It was important for Peter to do this because this mess could have been a hindrance for the people, moving forward. This could have been a hindrance for those hearing the message of Christ as well. For whatever reason, y'all, sometimes we have a tendency to shy away from God because we have come to think in our minds that God cannot work through mess. I mean, think about it, y'all. Jesus chose Judas as one of his disciples and later apostles, and this same man betrayed him and sold him out to the very authorities that wanted him dead. Judas aided in the capture and killing of Jesus, and many of us, even still today, are still asking why. And Peter, y'all, helps to make sense of this mess by showing that God can even work through mess, and he uses scripture to aid in how they saw God's activity even in these unfortunate events. He references Psalm 69 as a passage of scripture that David uses when he is referencing his enemies who have lied on him. He helps them to see that Judas's actions weren't surprising to God, and that scripture has already given testimony to these kinds of situations. In other words, Peter calls people's attention to the word in order to help them to make sense of this mess. Sounds like what we hear each and every Sunday. And my brothers and sisters, this is something that we need to have in order for the work to go on in this day and age. We need to continue to find ourselves grounded in the word so that we can help to make sense of some of the mess that we see in this world. Some of us are so stuck on the mess that we are struggling to see our place in helping the work to go on. And there are times when God will send folk who will help us to understand that while the situation was messy, it still doesn't derail the plan of the master. Can I say that one more time? That while the situation was messy, it still does not derail the plan of the master. And there are some of us right now who have gone through some messy situations in our lives, and as we look back on them now, we see that the mess did not cancel God's plan. Oh yes, my sisters and brothers, we know that the pandemic has been messy, but it hasn't stopped the plan of the master. Can I come on down your row and preach to you for just a moment? I know that planning that funeral was messy, but it still didn't stop the plan of the master. I know that getting that child through school was messy, but it didn't stop the plan of the master. I know that going through that nasty divorce was messy, but it didn't stop the plan of the master. I know that having them stab you in the back and talk about you like a dirty dog was messy, but it still didn't stop the plan of the master. I know that overcoming that addiction was messy, but it didn't stop the plan of the master. I know that working with some of the hellions in and outside of the church has been messy, but it didn't stop the plan of the master. And can I just have a few folk who can give God praise for the fact that while you may have gone through some mess, it didn't stop the plan of the master for your life. That even though you've gone through some things, even though you experienced some things, that God's will was still done in your life, that you're still standing because of the fact that God had a plan for you. And if I were to go on even further, I want to say that sometimes the mess helped to remove people that didn't need to go into the next season with us. That the mess revealed who was really in our corner. The mess showed us some areas where we needed to grow. The mess showed us that the Lord can make our enemies our footstool. The mess showed us that can't nobody do us like Jesus. And sometimes our prayer needs to be, God, help me to make sense of this mess. And what Peter does, y'all, is that Peter helps the people to make sense of the mess, to see that God still has a purpose in the matter. And there are some of us who have been through so much in our lives that we're starting to wonder if God even has a purpose for us. We've been disrespected. We've been talked about. We've been abandoned. We've been overlooked. And after all that we've been through, I'm still dropping by to let us know that God still has a plan for our lives. But not only does Peter help the people to understand that the work must go on by helping them to make sense of the mess, but he also motivates them to move forward. Here in the text, we see verse 20 says, For said Peter, it is written in the book of Psalms, may his place be deserted. Let there be no one to dwell in it. And may another take his place of leadership. Here in the text, we see that as Peter quotes scripture, he urges us to come to know that the work must go on by showing that the text suggests that someone else must take up the mantle. Here we see that what had taken place in this messy situation didn't end with Judas, but all this did was create another vacancy for someone else to step up and serve in his place. What we come to see is that Peter, not only in this text, but even as we read further, helps it to be known that in order for the work to go on, we must move forward. This helps us because oftentimes we come to believe that offices, titles, and even positions are synonymous with a person instead of their intended desire to be connected to the work. And while there may be people who are in our lives who do not live up to the demands of the role that they are supposed to be playing, the work still must go on. That's not only in the church, that's not only at work, that's not only in our families, but also in our lives. And I like this today, y'all, because it helps us to set our sights on the blessing of the vacancy and not the trauma of the departure. Let me say that one more time, because this text helps us to focus on the blessing of the vacancy and not the trauma of the departure. Let me go ahead and come down your pew before I close this thing on out. There are some of us right now who have some vacancies in our lives that we didn't predict, and for some of us, we did not desire. And we have cried our tears on out. We have stayed up in the midnight hour. We have asked God why, and we have come to realize that in this season, it is still time for us to move forward. We have vacancies in our relationships. We have vacancies in our friendships. We have vacancies in who we can trust. We have vacancies in who we can depend on. But baby, I just want you to know on today that is just an opportunity for God to provide just what we need. And when we move forward, we just allow for God to give us what we need as opposed to crying over what we had. And there are some of us even right now who need to make room for God to give us what we need as opposed to keep on going to God as we're crying over what we had. I know that there are some of us who are wondering, what should I have done to make them stay? But as we move forward, we come to see what God has in store for us. And as I bring this thing on to a close, I just wanted to remind us that the work has to go on. And as we come to find ourselves with vacancies in our lives, we come to realize that sometimes God removes some folk out of our lives only to make room for God
for who God is sending into our lives. And all I'm saying is that life doesn't stop just because someone decides to leave our lives. And as we trust God, we have to know that the work must go on, because the same God who kept us before is the same God who will keep us now. The same God who watched over us then is the same God who's watching over us now. The same God who was able to handle us then is the same God who's able to handle us now. And so it's possible for us to move forward even if we have tears in our eyes, because we come to believe and trust that as God takes us forward, that God isn't going to leave us by ourselves. And so as we move forward in our journey, as we move forward in our lives, as we move forward in our ministries, as we move forward in our aspirations, we know that the work must go on. The work of growing, the work of becoming better, the work of doing ministry, the work of striving to go higher, the work of building that business, the work of educating those children, the work of doing what we need to do so that God can be pleased with our lives. And all I'm saying today, church, is that God will be with us. God will work it out for us. And even when there are vacancies, the Lord will send the right folk into our experience. And so I say, hold on and continue to believe that the work must go on. Amen, amen, and amen. The doors of the church are now open, my brothers and my sisters, as we realize that the work of ministry, the work of life, the work of becoming better must go on. As we're gathered here now, there may be somebody out there who needs to have a closer relationship with God. That may be you on today, where you need a closer relationship with God. And so if that's you, I invite you now. You may need to be baptized. You may need a church home. You may need to rededicate yourselves to the Lord. If that's you on today, I invite you to know that this is the right time. It's time for you to move forward into a deeper relationship with God. And so if that's you today, as you gather together worshiping with us virtually, you can unmute yourself. You can make yourself known in the chat. You can even DM us on our social media page, or even shoot us some information on our website. Whatever way you can reach out to us, please do so, so that we can wrap our arms around you. We believe here at the Metropolitan Church that extra effort wins, and we want to put forth our best effort to making sure that you can become all that God has called you to be. And so if there's somebody out there today who finds himself in a position where they want to become closer to the Lord, I invite you to do so now at this time. There may be somebody out there today. There may be somebody out there today who needs a closer relationship with the Lord. And if that's you, I invite you to make yourself known at this time so that we can wrap our arms around you. Let us pray. Oh, gracious and all-wise God, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your care. We thank you for your mercy. Thank you for your steadfast kindness toward us. And now, O Lord, we ask that you might continue to cover and keep us. Bless everyone under the sound of my voice. God, as the word has gone forward today, letting us know that the work must go on, Lord, many of us are trying to make sense out of some of the mess that we've experienced in our lives. We pray that this word has helped with that. But not only, God, we realize that there is a word going forth that's trying to motivate us to move forward. That it's not a bad thing, God, to have a vacancy in our life, because it only gives us an opportunity, only gives you an opportunity to fill that vacancy with just what we need.
So God, we know that you're sending the right people. God, we know that you're adding the right folk to our lives. And Lord, we believe that you will continue to take care of us even in unfamiliar seasons. So Lord, thank you for what you're doing. In Christ's name we do pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Amen. As we now move forward in our worship experience, I want to take this time now to remind us, or as we go into our offertory period, I want to thank you all for your sacrifices, for your diligent work, for your extra effort, and making sure that we have been able to weather the storm in this season. God has been good to us, and we're thankful that the Lord has been able to use vessels like you to be faithful and committed to the work of making sure that we can spread the good news of Jesus Christ. And so, for those of us who are gathered here today, I want to remind all of us that we give in three ways here at the Metropolitan Church. We give in a way that is prayerful, where we ask God to guide us in our giving, because the Lord knows what we have, and the Lord also knows what is on the way. We give in a way that is generous, where we model God-like behavior. We want to be like God even as we give. And we give generously, where it's a mentality and a way that we govern ourselves like God. And so we want to give generously in a way once God has guided us in our giving. But not only that, we give in a way that is joyous, where we get excited about the fact that the Lord is going to bless the work of the ministry because of our faithfulness and because of our stewardship. But also the Lord is going to bless us because we are being obedient to what the Lord has told us to do. And there's nothing better than us being obedient to God, because we know that obedience is better than sacrifice. And so we desire to be a church, a body of believers who are obedient to the will of our God, because we know that not one of us possesses ownership of this church, but rather this is the Lord's church, and we have been charged to be stewards of it. And so we are thankful today for your contributions, for your work, for your time, for your effort. I was talking on yesterday to a fine group of leaders about the plan, and we were going over the logistics of reopening our church. We were able to realize that as we move forward in both virtual spaces and also physical spaces, that the Lord is enlarging our territory. We're going to exist in both virtual spaces and physical spaces, trying to make as much room as possible for those who want to be connected to God. And we know that that is not an easy feat, but we know with your support, your contributions, and your help that that is possible. So I encourage all of you to continue to remain sacrificial, to continue to remain invested, because we realize that we're taking on new territory. But with God's faithfulness, we know that we'll be just fine. And so for those of us who are desiring to drop off our contributions at our church, you can do so each and every Friday at from 9 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. here at our church located at 767 Walker Avenue in the heart of South Memphis. You can also send your gifts securely to our church, to our P.O. Box 262, Memphis, Tennessee, 38101. You can also give through the app Givelify and also through online giving via PayPal. And both links are located on our church website, www.extraeffortwins.org. And we want to thank God for you and for all that you continue to do to make sure that we can continue to put forth extra effort in ministry during this season. Let us now go to God as we pray and bless our offering. Oh God, we thank you for each and every gift. We thank you for each and every giver. Lord, we pray that you look after not only your church, but God, that you look over its members, look over its community, look over its partners, look over those whom we are called to serve. God, we pray that you might provide for us every single thing that we need. That God, that you would take care of us, watch over us,
and do what only you can do. So, Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your grace. We thank you for all that you continue to do in this season. Lord, bless our gifts. Bless our intention. And God, I continue to pray for those who desire to even give more or to do more, that God, you would make room, that you would make room for them as well. In Christ's name, we do pray. Amen, amen, and amen.